A couple weeks ago, when I was meeting with the staff, I was talking to Josh about the Gospels, or the four biographies that start the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the four biographies of Jesus. And we were discussing, actually, we ended up discussing which was our favorite of these, but it started by me posing which was our least favorite of these. Not that they're not all good, I like them all, but I told them that Luke is my least favorite of the four the four biographies that start the New Testament about Jesus. Hilariously, this is, since coming on staff here, this is my third Sunday speaking, and this is going to be my third week speaking from Luke. So I don't know if I'm just like digging into, I'm like, I need to figure out what's good about Luke, but I'm really pumped to dig in this morning. We're going to be in Luke 9, 57 to 62. Now, I want to do something a little bit different. Maybe for some of you, you'll love this. Maybe for some of you, this will be a little bit uncomfortable. Don't worry, I'm just the temp, so I'm not here forever. So if I do something that makes you uncomfortable, you can be like, well, this too will pass. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to, and this is one of my favorite things I do sometimes when I speak, is I'm going to read the passage. And then I'm actually going to take a few minutes and invite us to turn to the some people beside us. Again, this isn't junior high where I'm going to dictate how big or small your group has to be, but maybe a couple people around you, two, three, four, whatever you want, and just discuss it for a few minutes. And discuss what's interesting to you, what sticks out to you, what questions are conjured up in your mind, what do you like, what do you not like, what do you find uncomfortable about this passage, whatever. So I'm going to read this story. It's a story of Jesus interacting with three different individuals in six verses. It's like action-packed, Luke 9, 57 to 62. So I'm going to read it, and then I'll get you guys to chat with each other for a few minutes. Luke 9, 57. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, Jesus, I will follow you wherever you go. Jesus replied, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. He said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first let me go and bury my father. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Jesus replied, no one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Now, there's a heavy chunk of verses. So, love to invite you. Just turn to a couple people around you. Chat for a few minutes. Doesn't need to be groundbreaking, but just what sticks out to you, what's interesting, what questions pop up. So, and I will just hop in and interrupt you mid-thought in a few minutes. So, give you 3 or 4 minutes. So, ready, set, go.
If I gain the whole world, but I lose my soul, what good does it do for me? So everything that I hold, I let it go, 'cause that's how it's supposed to be. Whoa, oh, all that's in my hands, I give it all back to you. In my hands, I give it all back to you. I give it all back to you. What we see on this side will burn away like flowers in a wildfire.
All right. I think we've all, after the last few years, been on a Zoom call where you're in a breakout room and all of a sudden it just gets cut off. So this is the in-person version of that. That's enough talking about Jesus, so please stop. No, a good salesperson would just tell you a little bit up front and then tell you a little bit later. And that is, in fact, what I've done, because I said I'm going to do something that might be a little bit uncomfortable. I'm just going to push it just a little bit further. This is the last thing. I would love for us to get to share a couple of the things that popped up in your groups. So I'm going to ask a couple of you, and maybe a little uncomfortable, but to share something that popped up in your group. And here's the beautiful thing, is that you could share something that someone else said in your group that was brilliant, and we're all going to give you the credit for it. So this is the best time to plagiarize. No, it's okay. But yeah, just love to hear a thought, something interesting, a comment, a question, a frustration, whatever it is that popped up in your group. Love to hear a couple of those, and then we'll... that will be the last push into the discomfort zone. So who would love to share first? Yeah, go for it, Annika.
We talked about how there's definitely like a sense of urgency. We discussed a little bit more about what he's talking about when he said, let the dead bury the dead, where he's probably referring to people that are like the dead ways, like the old ways. So he's like, don't worry about, that, like they'll bury them for you basically. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks for sharing that. That's wonderful. Thanks. Thanks for being brave. A couple more. Who would love to share? Who'd be willing to share?
My soul, what good does it do for me?
Thanks, Adele. You usually, when someone volunteers someone else, then I'm usually like, okay, Adele, let's hear it. But you know, and I'm kind of new here, I don't want to make too many enemies yet. So.
Adele mentioned that there were some buts in the passage. Jesus has a butt, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And then the one individual says, but let me first say farewell to my family. So that was one thing we took away.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you so much for sharing that. Actually, it's like, you know, funny. We're all trying to pretend we're not in junior high when we hear the word but. But it's like, there are a lot of, the word but is one of the most powerful words in the Bible. You read the Sermon on the Mount, you've heard this but, and it shows up a lot. So great observation there. One more. Who else would love? Oh, yeah, Denise, one of our guests. I love it. Thanks.
I just picked out what Jesus said. So I like highlighted, Jesus says, follow me. He says, spread good news. And he says, be fit for the kingdom. And so I love God's word.
I love that. Thank you so much for sharing. Okay, we'll wrap it up there. Thanks for sharing, guys. I love doing that because it's easy, I think, to come and sit and listen to a person and then kind of not engage that much. And I just live in the assumption that I'm not the only person in the room that has something worth saying. And so thank you so much for sharing some of those thoughts and for digging in together like that. What I want to do is I just want to work through the text like I normally do. There are three interactions here. I just want to make a comment on each one of these. And what I'd love all of us to maybe do is to think about if we're in our own life, when we struggle or find the challenge to follow Jesus and stay faithful to Jesus, perhaps one of these characters, I'm going to make an observation, well, some observations about them, but maybe kind of a bit of a tagline about each of them. Which of these characters, like, do you maybe identify with the most, or which of these challenges do you find might slow you down or delay or deter you in your pursuit of following Jesus? And one thing I want to say right at the top of this is you can see this giant title of the message this week, Following Jesus is Difficult. I want to say I'm really sorry if you have grown up in a church experience or been part of a church experience that has kind of spread this idea that, like, you know, following Jesus is really easy and he just make your life wonderful and it's going to be best and it's going to be so great. And, you know, Jesus is like stroking a lamb and just like, you know, it's all like hugs and kisses. And, you know, I'm sorry if that's been your experience, because what happens is eventually you pick up the Bible and you start to read how Jesus describes following Jesus. And you realize, oh, there's a lot of fine print here to this Christianity thing. If you've been told that it's easy, and then all of a sudden you start reading the words of Jesus, you start to realize, I'm like, oh, this is actually not so easy. Following Jesus is extremely difficult. This happens in sales a lot, and I think it's kind of the basis of kind of what we call the attractional church. The attractional church is like, let's get them in with like a really like easy, soft selling message, and then hopefully later they figure out the rest of the stuff. So I had, I have TELUS Wi-Fi at home, and not like an endorsement or a diss or anything, just it's who they have. And they called me the other night. This guy calls me, he's like, hey, Ryan, just wanted to check, how's your Wi-Fi? I'm like, that's great, thanks. And he's like, you know, I'm really excited. I want to let you know, we want to make sure you're always getting the best deal, the best value. And he's like saying all this good stuff. And I'm like, there is some like butt coming at some point, you know, like there's some turnaround here. He's like, we just want to make sure you're satisfied, all that, blah, blah, blah. I was on for a while. He's like, so what we want to offer you for the next 2 years is internet at $115 a month. And I don't know what you guys are paying, but I'm currently paying $67 with TELUS. I was like, what? I was like, no. And he's like, normally it's $140, but we want to give it to you for $115. I was like, what? That's like, dude, that's like $48 more than what I'm paying. He's like, yeah, yeah, but your contract's about to end, so now we just want to make sure you get the best. And I was like, this is really bad news. No wonder there was so much like wind up at the start to like make me feel like this guy's my friend and he loves me and all that, because all of a sudden he's about to tell me my bill's about to double. You know, imagine how that feels. You go to church, oh, following Jesus is so easy, it's so fun, it's so comfortable, and all of a sudden you start reading passages like Luke 9:57-62, or parts where Jesus says, take up your cross, deny yourself daily. It might be like hating your family because there's going to be conflict and tension and all that. And Jesus says that, you know, following him is to be someone who's poor in spirit, someone who mourns. Like, there is challenge in following Jesus. Is it the best path? Is it the most rewarding? Is it the most fruitful path? For sure. But Jesus never says, oh, it's super simple. He says it's a difficult, challenging path. So here are these three interactions where Jesus makes this really clear. As they were walking along the road, a man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. If you just read that verse, you're like, awesome. This guy is in. This guy's great. Now, this is a really short story, like two verses per person. Not that that's how it was originally written, but it's really short. We don't know everything that's going on here, but I think there's some observations that we can make here. This guy says, I will follow you wherever you go. You think Jesus would be like, oh, this is amazing. This is incredible. This is perfect. You are in. What does he say? He says, foxes have dens and birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head. So basically he looks at the guy and says, I'm homeless. And we assume, scholars assume, that that's kind of the end of the dialogue. And the guy's like, ooh. This man, you can actually read about him also in the book of Matthew. And in the book of Matthew, in the NIV, he's called the teacher of the law. In the ESV, he's called a scribe, which is a better translation, I think. This is someone who like is responsible for copying down scriptures, copying down religious texts. This is like a small group's pastor at a larger church. Like, this is someone who's got like a middle management job in the religious institution of the day, who's doing well. His life's probably fairly comfortable. He's probably respecting his community. Things are fine. Things are going okay. He's affirmed by his community, by the religious folks around him, and things are going all right. But he comes up to Jesus, the scribe, and he says, I'll follow you wherever you go. And Jesus' response is so interesting, because if someone comes up to me and says, I'll follow you wherever you go, I'd be like, oh, well, I'd be like, that sounds weird. But I'd be like, this sounds like this person really wants to shadow me. But Jesus sees something in this guy's heart and intentions that are different. And he responds by the lack of like financial stability that he has. He responds by the lack of comfort and luxury that exists in the kingdom of Jesus. It's really interesting. Here's what I imagine. This is Ryan conjecture. You can take it or leave it. But it's got to be something, I think, kind of close to this. Here's this scribe, someone who's educated. They know the scripture. They know religion. They know the way of Yahweh. They know these things. A decent amount of knowledge. He strolls up and he sees Jesus, who's collecting this crowd. We know that lots of crowds follow Jesus. Jesus will feed like thousands of people miraculously. Jesus is healing people, bringing people back from the, like, it's crazy. So he sees all this going on, all this commotion. And he sees Jesus as like kind of his team, his staff team, these 12 guys. And what are they? Like failed fishermen. One guy's a tax collector. One guy's this like pseudo-terrorist called a zealot. Like, they're these young guys that are kind of like whatever. I don't know if you guys ever do this, but do you ever look at a task and you don't say this out loud, but you're like, if they can do it, I can do it, right? Anybody ever? I'll be honest, this is going to sound brutal, but when we first were thinking about having kids, I was like, I don't know, man, like I might just mess these kids up. But I looked around me at a lot of parents who had kids. I was like, you know what? It's not like these guys are superstars. You know, it's like, they can do it, I can do it. And usually we find examples that are kind of like a low bar so we can compare ourselves well. I imagine this guy strolling up. Jesus is picking up a lot of momentum. He's trending, all that. And he looks at his group of 12. And it's kind of like that smart person who bought a whole bunch of Bitcoin back in like 2016, who gets in on the startup really early on. It's like, you know what? This thing is going somewhere. And I imagine this guy looks at this movement, is gaining a lot of people. And he's like, I'm a small group pastor at like a decent sized local church, but I could be part of this huge religious movement that's going to take over. And if I join this team full of fishermen, tax collectors, that kind of thing, if I join this team, like I could be like CFO. I could be, you know, a real position in this thing. That's the story I've made up behind this guy. I don't know if it's exactly like that, but there is obviously this desire for this guy to experience like success, luxury, comfort, growth, the types of things that the world says these things will make you feel satisfied and fulfilled. And he's talking to Jesus, who we know will teach people there's only one way you can find satisfaction and fulfillment. It's to forsake those things and to come and follow me. And Jesus responds by saying, I'm a homeless guy. Tonight, I'm going to be sleeping in a ditch with these 12 guys. We don't have a house. We're not going to be like feasting on some big buffet. When this guy says, I'll follow you wherever you go, what I imagine is this guy is talking about those big, awesome moments, those viral moments where it's just like the feeding the 5,000, brings the kid back from the dead, all those things that are so exciting. I'm going to be there for those. And here's kind of the tagline I would offer for this guy. I would say this, you can't follow Jesus anywhere unless you're willing to follow him everywhere. Jesus is not looking for people who are like, oh, you'll be there in those exciting moments when I'm healing people, when I'm feeding all these people, when I'm doing all these things, when the crowds are big. But we see many moments where Jesus, if you've read the story of the feeding of the 5,000, it shows up in all four of the Gospels. What happens afterwards? The people bail. He goes from like thousands and thousands of people to the next morning, they're hungry, he doesn't have breakfast for them, so they peace out. And in one of the Gospels, he looks at his friends and he says, are you guys going to leave too? Like he gives them the option. He's like, you want to go? This is your chance. And they say, we're going to stay. Those are the everywhere moments when everybody leaves, when everybody's abandoning, when Jesus is about to get nailed to a cross. Jesus is looking for those people and says, I will follow you wherever you go. I will follow you everywhere. The everywhere moments. Monday when we're at work, it's easy on a Sunday when everyone else is singing the songs. When we're singing together, oh yeah, we're all in on the anywhere moments, you know. We're all in on those. And Jesus says, until every moment of your life is a life surrendered to me, you're not going to follow me anywhere. It needs to be in the everywhere, the Monday, the Tuesday, all of that. One more fascinating thought and then that I've thought about a bit, and then we'll move on to the next dude. We've heard of those like tragic moments where there's like a shooting in like a Christian school or something like that happens in the States. And we hear about it way too much. But perhaps you've heard those stories where the gunman, like, or the gunner, it's usually dudes, but the gun person, goes to the people and says, deny your faith, denounce your faith, or else we're going to kill you. And you hear these epic stories of these people who are like, I'll never deny Jesus, and then they get tragically killed. It's very sad. And I've, you know, over the years, I've talked to people about this, and I've heard many people say, I would never deny my faith. I would never do it. I would, like, for sure be like, no, I love Jesus, I'll take the bullet, all that, which is very noble. However, then I've thought about it, I'm like, but how many times in, like, my normal day-to-day life, how many times when we go to school or we go to our workplace, do we not deny Jesus all the time and there's not even a gun involved this time? No one's even like pointing anything at us. And it's just like we shy away and we deny Jesus and we shy away from the opportunities to follow him everywhere. You won't follow him anywhere unless you're willing to follow him everywhere. Jesus isn't looking for these kind of like, yeah, show up when the crowd's there, show up when the momentum's there, show up on Sunday mornings. But he's looking for people who says, I want to be part of your life. I want to be Lord of your life in every moment. Verse 59, he said to another man, follow me. I feel sad for this middle guy because the two guys, they initiated the conversation, but it seems here Jesus like calls this guy out, and this guy gets then memorialized for thousands of years in this story where he doesn't say the right thing. But he said to another man, follow me. But he replied, Lord, master, first let me go and bury my father. That's pretty reasonable, right? Like probably about the most reasonable. Funerals are trump cards, right? Anybody's like, something's going on. Like you could have like real tension or conflict with a person, and then they like someone they know dies, and it's like the conflict is on hold. Funerals are trump cards. So obviously Jesus says, oh yes, I'm so sorry to hear about your loss. My condolences. What's the address where I can send the flowers? How can I make some freezer meals for you and your family? Right? Jesus, he's gentle, stroking a lamb. Of course he says something like that. No, how brutal is Jesus? Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. Let the dead bury their own dead. I'm one of Jesus's followers, and I'm like, in that moment, I'm like, hey, Jesus, I know you said you created the whole world, but I'm not sure if you understand how basic biology works. Dead people burying dead, like Jesus, that actually isn't possible for dead people to bury dead people. You know, I'm one of his followers, and I'm just like, this is the moment where I leave her. I'm just like, oh, that's so insensitive, Jesus. This guy's talking about this thing. Now, to give a little bit of like, again, this is a short story, so scholars work for years and years and years to try to like parse this out. But most commentators and most scholars believe that this guy's dad isn't actually dead yet. This guy's, and not that he's saying he's going to bury his father alive, but his dad isn't dead yet. What he means by burying his father is he's saying, let me go and live out the last stages of my dad's life with him and take care of him. Let me go deal with his estate. This is maybe crass, but what I often think of it is, my dad, in Jewish culture, the dad used to change your diapers when you were little. Now that he's very old and he needs that service returned, then the son's responsibility is to go and do that for the father, to take care of them while they're unwell and they can't take care of themselves, they can't manage themselves or whatever, as they're getting old, to make it comfortable, to take care of them, to manage the estate, and to care for them in their dying moments. In our culture, I mean, that's kind of normal, except now we have the luxuries of like homes and all that. In Jewish culture, this is incredibly important, and it was actually based on a commandment that Jesus taught in the Old Testament, to honor your father and mother. It's like, take care of your parents, honor them, love them, respect them, care for them. In Jewish culture, this was huge. You would be a total deadbeat. You'd be a loser in your culture, in your society. People would look at you like, man, like what a failed son this is, for them to leave in these moments. But Jesus says, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. It's interesting what this guy says. He's like, Lord, I want to do this, but first let me do this, but first let me do this, but first let me do this. This is what I would say. I would say you'll never put Jesus first if you're focused on your but first. You'll never put Jesus. How often do we do this? Oh, I want to be more generous. I want to give more money, but first I need to pay off my student loan, but first I need to make more money, but first. What we've learned about generosity is that actually, if you have more, you give less. The North American church, on average, people give a lower percentage of their income today than they did during the Great Depression. Isn't that wild? During the Great Depression. And I think we're doing a little bit. I realize, you know, an apple's like $10 right now, but like, we're rich. We're less generous. But first, let me do this. But first, let me do this. I want to read my Bible first, but first, I got to get through this thing. But first, I got to do this. But first, my kids are still under 7 years old, and it's chaos in my house. But first, I want to spend more time praying. But first, I want to share my faith with my friends. But first, I need to figure out more. But first, I need to learn more. But first, this. But first. We have so many but firsts. I love the example that Jesus uses here because, you know, if it was like, this guy was like, hey, Jesus, I'll follow you, but like, I want to go like make my first million, or like, I want to go do something like that, it would be easy for us to be like, yeah, it's not very noble. He actually says the most noble thing you could think of doing, if that distracts you from following me, then it's not worth doing. There's this old preacher named Charles Spurgeon, like he lived a long time ago, and maybe you've heard of him. It doesn't matter if you haven't. But he talks about this, and what he says, and this is a paraphrase, is he says, much of life's duties, like political involvement, social involvement, community involvement, the extracurriculars, lots of the things that we see as noble, are the things that any person, whether they're a follower of Jesus or not, can do. So he says, so let us leave all of that work to those who are not, who have not been transformed by Jesus, and let us who have been transformed by Jesus dedicate our time and energy and focus, first of all, to expanding the kingdom of Jesus, to sharing the message of Jesus. Let the other people be good at the sports. Let the other people be better at school, at academics, at jobs, at money, at all of the things. Let those who are spiritually dead thrive in those areas, and we will take care of the most important thing, and that is bringing spiritual life and spiritual transformation in the world around us. We can't put Jesus first if we're focused on our but first. There are so many but firsts, and even the most noble sounding ones, we have such a good way of like justifying our excuses and our reasons for this and that. And I love how Jesus challenges like one of the most noble things you could ever say. I'm going to go deal with my dad's estate. I'm going to go care for him. And Jesus says, if that's your priority over following me, then you're just not part of my kingdom. And this third guy, I hope this third guy didn't hear these first two conversations, because if he did, this guy's kind of a moron for piping up at this point, but it's his fault. Still another said, I will follow you, Lord, but first let me go back and say goodbye to my family. Again, quite reasonable, right? I want to go kiss my mama goodbye. If I'm Jesus, I'm like, yeah, that's important, man. Like, you should go do that. Jesus replied, brutal. No one who puts a hand to the plow and looks back is fit for service in the kingdom of God. Again, we don't have the whole story here, but there's something that we can see there that Jesus is responding to that is showing that this guy's allegiance or ties are not fully where he's saying he is. It's easy for us to say something, but our actions and our beliefs aren't actually there. Jesus, I'm going to follow you. Jesus, I'm going to follow you. That sounds good. But Jesus sees there's something that's more important to him there. Here's what I imagine when he goes back home to talk to his family. Again, this is conjecture. I don't have a translation of the Bible that has more words than yours or whatever. But imagine he goes home. It's Thanksgiving dinner. The whole family's together. He sits down and he's like, hey, you know what? There's this new rabbi, Jesus. Maybe you've heard of him. Like, oh yeah, I've heard of this guy. Like, his name's like, you know, it's like he's all over my Instagram feed. Like, he's really like popping right now. And like, yeah, this guy, this rabbi, he invited me to follow him. And his parents are like, wow, that's like really exciting. Like, how much does this internship pay? It's like, well, you know, a few verses before me, he told this guy that he doesn't even have a house. Like, that's the CEO doesn't have a house. So, like, I assume us as, like, interns, we probably don't have much. Well, where do you stay? I think they just, like, camp out in ditches with, like, a fire at the end of the day. Okay, well, like, you know, like, is it, you know, is it good on your resume and stuff? Well, you know, I've been hearing some murmurs for the religious institution. They're all, like, planning to murder this guy. They're all trying to kill him. It's like, well, is it safe for you? Jesus has talked about us drinking from that same cup of persecution. And he says, blessed are you when you're persecuted. And it seems actually like there's a big chance that we might get like beaten, persecuted, maybe even killed for this thing. I mean, what reasonable parent is like, that sounds great. Checks all my boxes. It's like what we're wired to. It's this conflicting nature that we have as parents. We want what's best for our kids, but sometimes we forget what's best for our kids. We want to keep our kids safe, but we sometimes forget that being safe by the world standards is like antithetical to us being safely in the hand of a loving God. I could imagine his parents being like, you know what? Heard about this other local rabbi. He's well-liked. It's like kind of less of a thing. Pays a little bit more. There's more of the security and the safety. This guy's probably grown up in a decent environment, provided for. He's got a family farm he can take over. It's comfortable. And it'd be really easy to look back to the past luxuries of life, the past comforts of life, the things that have been part of his story there so far. When Jesus shows up, he actually disrupts our story. He disrupts it and he says, I'm going to make you a new creation. That old story, it's come to an end and here's the new story. But it's very hard for us to let go of the past, of our story in our lives, in our jobs, even in our like church communities, that it's hard for us to let go of those stories and embrace them. And I would say that if you won't let go of your past, you will forfeit the future Jesus has for you. Jesus said to this guy, I don't think Jesus is saying, hey, can't like go say bye to your mom. But I think Jesus is saying, hey, listen, like, I hear what's going on. You're going to go and you're going to be focused on like what you're letting go of. You're going to be hanging on to that. It's going to be really hard. And until you let go of that, until you're willing to like plow the field in the kingdom of heaven without looking back and lamenting that. Not saying no one ever struggles, but unless you're willing to let go of that, you can't fully embrace what I have for you. This is a really challenging passage because, you know, I invited you guys to maybe think about which one of these characters you identify with the most. For me, I can see aspects of all three of them in my life where I often struggle with these but first. I often struggle just wanting to be in the kind of like the anywhere moments, the special moments. And I struggle letting go of my past. I struggle letting go of the things, the patterns that I've been taught are important for me in this life. I struggle figuring out what that looks like. And I don't have any big takeaway that can tell you how to fix that or to change that. But I will tell you that there's a Jesus, a God, who invites all of us out of that and says, listen, in your struggle with those things that you're holding on to, I've got something so much rewarding and life-giving for you. So I'd encourage you this week, think about these three characters. Maybe read this again. It's quite short. It's not a lot of homework. And maybe say, you know, Jesus, where am I in this story? And what is it that you'd be inviting me inviting me out of and into in this next season of life? I think if we ask ourselves questions like that, Jesus will certainly show up and answer. There's scary answers to hear. But he'll challenge us and he'll provoke things and it will call us to be a little bit less safe. It will call us to let go of some comforts and some luxuries. It will call us to step out of our comfort zone. But it's life-changing. I know in every moment where I've done something that seems kind of foolish and let go of some things for Jesus, there's been something so much better on offer after that. Love for the band to come up. We're going to enter into a time of communion.